Hello everyone, and I'm so happy to be able to worship with you on this, the last day of 2023. Where has this year gone? Anyway, let's pause for this moment as the year ends and come together and worship God. The call to worship is, if anyone acknowledges that Jesus is the Son of God, God lives in him and he in God. And so we know and rely on the love God has for us.
The church is one foundation, is Jesus Christ her Lord. She is his new creation by water and the word. From heaven he came and sought her to be his holy bride. With his own blood he bought her, and for her life he died. Elect from every nation, yet one o'er all the earth. Her charter of salvation, one Lord, one faith, one birth. One holy name she blesses, partakes one holy food. And to one hope she presses, with every grace in due. On this foundation, we make our stand. Hell cannot stop us, nor scheme of man. And when storms threaten, the earth to give way, God, you are strong. By schisms rent asunder, by heresies distressed. Yet saints their watch are keeping, their cry goes up how long. And soon the night of weeping shall be the morn of song. Mid toil and tribulation and tumult of her war, she waits the consummation. nation of peace forevermore. Till with a vision glorious, her longing eyes are blessed, and the great church victorious shall be the church at rest. On this foundation we make our stand. Hell cannot stop us, nor scheme of man. And when storms threaten the earth to give away, God, you are stronger, my hope and stay.
Let's come together in an attitude of prayer. Let's bow our heads. Almighty, all-powerful God, our heads are bowed before you because you are Almighty God. We know that, we acknowledge that, we're looking back over a year that has passed, and we see you involved with us and in our lives every step of the way as that year that has just ended progressed. We thank you so much for that. We know that you are our God who watches over us, and for that we give you all praise and glory. We confess there were many times in this year that has just passed where we took our eyes off you and wondered what was going on, not realizing you were involved with us nonetheless. We confess that there were times when we cried out in anguish, perhaps even in anger, as to what was going on, not realizing that everything is under your control. And for those moments, we ask your forgiveness, we ask for your grace, your mercy, and we repent of those times when we didn't sit quietly knowing that you were with us anyway. We thank you for all that you have done for us in this past year. We thank you for everything that you have allowed to happen to us, because always your hand was on our lives, guiding and protecting and providing. And we also think now of others who might not perhaps realize that as much as we do. And we ask you, Lord, to reach into their lives and let them know that you are there. You always will be, you always were, and that you will not ever forsake them or let them go. Reassure them, Lord, as we speak to you about them now, in the situations that they are facing, be it health-wise, financially, familial, employment, whatever. Draw near to the people we are speaking to you about now. We name them to you, and we ask that you draw close and let them feel your nearness, your presence, and let them gain comfort from that. We ask that in the name of Jesus. And the disciples came to him and said, Lord, teach us to pray. He answered, pray like this. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
This is my desire to honor you, Lord, with all my heart I worship you. And all I have within me I give you praise, and all that I adore is in you. Lord, I give you my heart, give you my soul, I live for you.
As the year ends, I think it's quite fitting that we turn to the Bible, God's infallible word without error, where God warns us of a time that is coming, and it is going to be terrible. There will be unbelievable suffering. Events will happen that we can't even begin to think of, not even in our wildest imaginings. And every one of them will be allowed by God himself. And as this new year stands before us, who knows, it might even be next year. And of course, I am talking about the events as detailed in the book of Revelation. These events are all in our future and haven't happened yet, although the signs are definitely there that these times are drawing closer. But Jesus cautions us in Matthew 24 in many places. In verse 36 he says, "No one knows about the day or hour, not even the angels in heaven, nor the Son, but only the Father." So to speculate about when all this is going to happen is fruitless and really a waste of time. So let's just accept that these events are going to happen, but we don't know exactly when. In Matthew 24, Jesus describes this time in these words: "The sun will be darkened, the moon will not give its light, the stars will fall from the sky, and the heavenly bodies will be shaken." He goes on to say that we must keep watch. And as this year ends and we stand ready to accept a new year, that is exactly what I plan to do with you today. I aim to provide you with knowledge and information to help you keep watch. You see, a number of terrible events are going to happen. For example, seven seals will be opened and symbolic horsemen will thunder out of heaven to deliver conquest, snatch all peace from earth, cause prices of essentials to absolutely rocket, cause death and destruction, cause earthquakes that blacken the sun, and stars will fall out of the sky to earth. Then trumpets will blow, and hail and fire will plunge to the earth. Mountains will tip into the sea, and a third of the sun will go dark. And then someone will emerge. Yes, it will be a person. Someone with great power and authority will rise. And during all these terrible events, men will turn to this someone and will begin to worship this someone. And then, look how it's described in Revelation chapter 13, verse 8. "All inhabitants of the earth will worship the beast, all whose names have not been written in the book of life that belongs to the Lamb that was slain from the creation of the world." Now, this is absolutely crucial, as here we have a piece of scripture, God's word, that reveals something to us, something of eternal importance. This someone, this beast, which will be a person, but not yet the Antichrist, that's for another time perhaps, will demand and receive that worship of all in the world. Look, the word "all inhabitants of the earth will worship the beast" is quite clear in scripture. Matthew Henry, in his great commentary, puts it this way: "The honor and worship paid to this infernal monster is subjection to the devil, and although there was no power able to withstand him, so great was the madness of the world." This so-called beast gained a sort of universal empire in the world, and the main purpose was to blaspheme God. The fate of those who worship the beast and the Antichrist, who then arrives and follows this beast, in Revelation 13:11 onwards, will be too terrible to think about. But I want to focus today on the second part of the scripture we have opened before us. Look at it again. "All those whose names have not been written in the book of life belonging to the Lamb will worship the beast." This is critical to us, because those whose names have been written in the book of life will not suffer the fate of those whose names are not written in the book. Now, we find the details in the book of life in Revelation 20, verse 15, and I read, "If anyone's name was not found written in the book of life, he was thrown into the lake of fire." Surely then, we must be desperate to find out how to get our names written in the Lamb's Book of Life, and not the other books where you get judged on what you did on earth and what chance do you stand then. Well, how do we get our names written in the Lamb's Book of Life? And how do we avoid falling into the trap of worshipping the beast? I'm going to let Jesus, in his own words, tell you that answer. In Luke 12, verse 8, Jesus says, "I tell you the truth, whoever acknowledges me before men, the Son of Man will also acknowledge him before the angels of God." In John 3:16 we find, "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son," listen, "that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life." And then in John 10:9 we find, "I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved." And of course my favorite scripture, John 14:6, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." I'm sure it's clear now. We believe in Jesus in full faith and trust. We declare him as our Savior. We have faith openly and unashamedly in Jesus. Our names are written in the Book of Life. And we won't be fooled into worshiping anyone or anything else, because our full faith and trust will be in Jesus. The ancient Greek that the original New Testament was written in writes the act of worship as proskuneia, and it's an act of homage or reverence. Now this act is to be reserved only for God and Jesus. Nothing and no one else is to get our proskuneia. It is to honor religiously again, which again is for God alone. It could also be interpreted as to serve. We cannot serve anything or anyone else except Almighty God himself. You see, in this act of worship, we give direct and total acknowledgement of God. We give that behavior to anything and anyone else, we blaspheme. Exactly as the beast that we read about was trying to get everyone to do in the world. Only God is worthy of our worship, which we are doing today. We bow down and praise, we give thanks, and we serve God and God only, no matter what. We must not ignore the fact that during these terrible times, as described in the book of Revelation, is going to be extremely difficult, but we'll be raptured long before it becomes too unbearable. Raptured? That's for another time. We must know about these times that are coming, and we must know about what the world is going to be expecting of us. These times could even begin in this coming new year. We should be ready and steadfast and resolute to worship the one and true and only God, and we need to be watching for this. Amen.
When we walk with the Lord in the light of his word, what a glory he sheds on our way. While we do his good will, he abides with us still, and with all who will trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Not a shadow cloud in the skies, but his smile quickly drives it away. Not a doubt nor a fear, not a sigh nor a tear can abide while we trust and obey. Oh, trust and obey, for there's no to trust and obey. Then in fellowship sweet, we will sit at his feet, or we'll walk by his side in the way. What he says, where he sends, we will go. Never fear, only trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Oh, trust and obey, there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. And 'tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise, just to know, thus saith the Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I proved him o'er and o'er. Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. Lord, oh, for grace to trust you
. I wrote these things to you who believe in the name of God, the Son of God, so that you may know that you have eternal life. Amen.